Zeus, A Study in Ancient Religion by Arthur Bernard Cook, Fellow and Lecturer of Queen's College, Cambridge, Reader in Classical Archaeology to the University of Cambridge. Volume 1, Zeus, God of the Bright Sky, Cambridge, at the University Press, 1914. Printed by John Clay, M.A. at the University Press. A child avenging mind. So did Calchas prophesy amid the usual blessings. Fateful words upon the march to the kings. And still, we like him sense pain to come. Say all go well, not ill. Zeus, whoever Zeus may be, if Zeus is for mortals to sing, by Zeus's name will I call to him, seeing not even everything, set in one scale counterbalances him, set in the other. To Zeus must I sing, if my false-conceiving mind's to be truly free, of the empty, senseless dread that encompasses me. Nor whatever sea devant, God broiling in all warring might, I will not even mention him, nor his successor slight. Zeus's forerunners are no match for him, his arm puts them to flight. The prudent mind awards Zeus victory, wisdom gives Zeus first place in piety. For Zeus's law is first in all the world. The law is this, no wisdom without pain. Slow process of the watching soul's unsleep. Distills tear drip of lament within. Wanted or not by us, such wisdom's gained. Its score, its etch, its scar. In us goes deep. The grace of the gods, the bright powers set on high, is overpowering, sharp, and voluntary. AESCHYLUS, Agamemnon, lines 154 to 184. The present volume is the first of two in which I have endeavored to trace the development and influence of Zeus. It would seem that the Greeks, starting from a sense of frank, childish wonder, not unmixed with fear, at the sight of the animate sky, mounted by slow degrees of enlightenment to a recognition of the physical, intellectual, and moral supremacy of the sky god. Dion Chrysotomos, in a memorable sentence, declared Zeus to be the giver of all good things, the father, the savior, the keeper of mankind. On the lower levels and slopes of this splendid spiritual ascent, the Greeks found themselves at one with the beliefs of many surrounding peoples, so that a fusion of the Hellenic Zeus with this or that barbaric counterpart often came about. On the higher ground of philosophy and poetry, they joined hands with a latter age and pressed on towards our own conceptions of deity. I have therefore felt bound to take into account not only the numerous adaptations of Levantine syncretism, but also sundry points of contact between Hellenism and Christianity. It is obvious that the limits of such an inquiry are to a certain extent arbitrary. I shall expect to be told by some that I have gone too far afield, by others that I have failed to note many side lights from adjacent regions. Very possibly both criticisms are true. Indeed, given the subject, it is not altogether easy to determine the best method of handling it. As a matter of fact, I have tried more ways than one. In the Classical Review for 1903 and 1904, I published a series of six papers on Zeus, Jupiter, and the Oak, which aimed at summarizing the Greek and Roman evidence that might be adduced in support of Sir James G. Frazer's Aeschylean hypothesis. Satisfied that the evidence was much stronger than I had at first supposed, I next attempted, rashly enough, to pursue the same theme into the Celtic, the Germanic, and the Leto-Slavonic areas. With the intent, I wrote another series of eight articles on the European sky god, which appears in folklore between the years 1904 and 1907. Of these articles, the first three restated, with some modifications, the results obtained on Greco-Italic ground, and the remaining five were devoted to a survey of analogous phenomena among the insular Celts. I had meant to go further along the same road, but at this point, Dr. Farnell, in the friendliest fashion, put a spoke in my wheel by convincing me that the unity of an ancient god consisted less in his nature than in his name. Thereupon, I decided to abandon my search for the European sky god, the Ural Anu, and I did so the more readily because I had felt with increasing pressure the difficulty of discussing customs and myths without a real knowledge of the languages in which they were recorded. After some hesitation, I resolved to start afresh on narrower lines, restricting inquiry to the single case of Zeus and marking out my province as explained in the previous paragraph. Even so, the subject has proved to be almost too wide. I incline to think that a full treatment of any of the greater Greek divinities, such a treatment as must ultimately be accorded to them all, properly demands the coordinated efforts of several workers. Be that as it may, in this installment of my book, I have traced the evolution of Zeus from sky to sky god, and have sought to determine the relations in which he stood to the solar, lunar, and stellar cults of the Mediterranean basin. I need not here anticipate my conclusions, since the volume opens with a table of contents and closes with a summary of results. But I would warn my readers that the story runs on from volume 1 to volume 2, and that the second half of it is, for the history of religion in general, the more important. Zeus, god of the bright sky, is also Zeus, god of the dark sky, and it is in this capacity, as lord of the drenching rainstorm, that he fertilizes his consort, the earth goddess, and becomes the father of a divine son, whose worship, with its rites of regeneration and its promise of immortality, taught that men might in mystic union be identified with their god, and thus in thousands of wistful hearts throughout the Hellenic world, awaken longing that could be satisfied only by the coming of the very Christ. Contents of Volume 1, Chapter 1, Zeus as God of the Bright Sky. Section 1, Zeus and the Daylight. A. Zeus the Sky. B. The Tradition from Sky to Sky God. C. Zeus Arios. D. Zeus Panamaros. Panimeros. Panimeros. Section 2, Zeus and the Burning Sky. A. Aether, as the abode of Zeus. Zeus, Aetherios, Zeus, Aetherios. C. Zeus identified with Aether, sometimes with air, in philosophy and poetry. D. Zeus as god of the blue sky in Hellenic or Hellenistic art. The blue nimbus, the blue globe, the blue mantle. Section 3. Zeus Lycaos. A. Wolf god or light god. B. Peloponnesian coin types of Zeus Lycaos. C. Human sacrifice to Zeus Lycaos. D. The precinct of Zeus Lycaos. E. The cult of Zeus Lycaos at Kyrene. F. Zeus Lycaos on a Spartan Cyrenaic Kylix. G. Zeus-like deities in wolf skin garb. Section 4. Zeus and Olympus. A. The cult of Zeus on Mount Olympus. B. Dionysiac traits in the cult of Zeus on Mount Olympus. C. Development and the meaning of Olympus. Zeus Olympios. Section 5. The mountain cults of Zeus. A. Chronological development of the mountain cults. B. The mountain as the throne of Zeus. C. The mountain as the birthplace of Zeus. D. The mountain as the marriage place of Zeus. E. The mountain as the burial place of Zeus. F. Zeus as a mountain god, superseded by Saint Elias. Section 6. Zeus in relation to the sun. A. Direct identifications of Zeus with the sun. B. Cult epithets of Zeus that may be solar. C. The sun as the eye of Zeus. D. The will as the sun as a will. Subsection I. The solar will in Greece. Subsection 2. Zeus and the solar will. Zeus and the solar disk. The Lycian symbol. The Lycian symbol and the Cyclops or Cleclops, Kyclops, the Kyclops of the East and the Kyclops of the West, the Kyclops and Zeus, the blinding of the Kyclops' eye, Prometheus's theft of fire, the fire drill in relation to Prometheus, the Kyclops and Zeus, the solar wheel combined with animals, the solar chariot, the solar wreath. E. The sun as the bird of Zeus. F. The sun and the ram. Subsection 1. The ram and the sun in Egypt. Zeus Amun. Khenemu and Amen. Amen and Zeus Thebaeus. Amen and Zeus Amun. Baal Ha'amon and Zeus Amun. Zeus Amun and the snake. Zeus and the oasis. A Greco-Libyan god, the youthful Amun, the oasis of Siwa. Subsection 2. The ram and the sun in Phrygia. The golden or purple ram of the Etruscans and Italians. The golden or purple lamb of Atreus, the cattle of the sun. The golden lamb in a folk tale from Epirus, the golden or purple ram of Phrixus, Zeus Actaeus or Achreus and his fleeces, Zeus Mielikios, Zeus Cetesios and the fleece of Zeus. The significance of the ram and the cult of Zeus. G. The sun and the bull and the sun in Egypt. Zeus, Io, and Epaphos, priests and priestesses with animal names. Hera and the cow. Cleobis and Biton, Trophonios and Agamedes, the Proetides, Hera and Io, Zeus and Argos, the myth of Pasiphae, the bull and the sun in Crete, the cow and the moon in Crete, the sacred cattle of Gortyna, the labyrinth at Gnosis, the Minotaur, Minoan bullfights, ritual horns, the marriage of the sun and the moon in Crete, Zeus and the bovine figures of Cretan mythology, 20, the bull and sun in Syria, subsection Aleph, or Alpha, Zeus, Adados, and Iupitor, Heliopolitanus, Iupitor, Heliopolitanus and the bull, Adad and Raman and the bull, Zeus Adad, and Hera Atargatis at Hierapolis, Zeus Adad at Dion, Rosos, etc. Characteristics of the Syrian Zeus Adad, Baal Tars, and Zeus Tercios, Zeus Dolicheos and Iopator Dolichinus, 21, the significance of the bull in the cults of Zeus, starting with Alpha, the bull as a fertilizing power, the influence of Apis, spread of the Hittite bull cult, the Cretan Zeus and Zagreus, the Cretan Zeus and human homophagy, the Cretan Zeus and bovine homophagy, the origin of tragedy, the Attic festivals of Dionysus, the satyric drama, Zeus, Dionysus, and the goat, 22, animal sacrifices to Zeus, H, the sun as a bronze man, I, Talos in Crete, Talos in Sardinia, Talos and the bronze founder's art, Talos at Athens, Talos identified with Zeus, Section 7, Zeus in relation to the moon. Direct identifications of Zeus with the moon. Zeus paired with Selena, Pandia. Zeus paired with Io, Pasiphae, Europe. Zeus paired with Antiope. Zeus and his lunar consorts. Section 8, Zeus in relation to the stars. Zeus, Asterios. Zeus, Siren. Zeus Oromestes, Zeus as god of the starry sky, Zeus in astronomy and astrology, Zeus transformed into a star, the Dioscuri as stars, the dedication of stars after the battles of Salamis and Aegios Potamos, the Dioscuri as stars in Hellenic literature, the Dioscuri with stars in Hellenistic art, the Dioscuri identified with the heavenly twins in Hellenistic literature, the Dioscuri identified with various stars by modern writers, the Dioscuri identified with St. Elmo's fire in Hellenistic literature, the Northern Lights, the star of the Dioscuri of Helling as a good or bad omen, St. Elmo's fire. Section 9, general conclusions with regard to Zeus as god of the bright sky. Then addenda, indexes of persons, places, festivals, subjects, authorities. And there's a list of plates. My plan is to read each section and the alpha of each section, leaving this ancient book at least in one form in the notes on YouTube. But if for some reason you're listening to this and there is no such thing called YouTube, and there is still the internet, then please direct yourself to archive.org, archive.org, and in their search function, type creator colon quotation mark cook comma space Arthur Bernard comma space 1868 dash space 1952 quotation mark search metadata and you'll find all of the books by this particular individual, including the various parts of this text. Chapter 1, Zeus as God of the Bright Sky. Section 1, Zeus and the Daylight. Alpha, Zeus the Sky. The supreme deity of the ancient Greeks, during their historical period at least, was Zeus. His name, referable to a root that means to shine, may be rendered the bright one. And since a whole series of related words in the various languages of the Indo-European family is used to denote day or sky, it can be safely inferred that Zeus was called the bright one. As being the god of the bright or daylight sky. Indeed, a presumption is raised that Zeus was at first conceived, not in anthropomorphic fashion as the bright sky god, but simply as the bright sky itself. True, the Greeks at the time, when their literature begins, had advanced far beyond this primitive view. Zeus in the Iliad is already the potent, if not omnipotent, ruler of the gods. The description of whose nod is said to have inspired Phidias' masterpiece at Olympia. So spake the son of Cronos, and thereto nodded with darkling brow the lordly locks ambrosial on his immortal head, shook at their shaking, all Olympus quaked. Nevertheless, although Zeus as conceived by the Homeric minstrel is fully anthropomorphic, certain traces of the earlier conception persisted even into post-Homeric times. The evidence is linguistic rather than literary. I shall begin by passing it in review. Nevertheless, although Zeus, as conceived by the Homeric minstrel, is fully anthropomorphic, certain traces of the earlier conception persisted even into post-Homeric times. The evidence is linguistic rather than literary. I shall begin by passing it in review. Closely akin to the substantive Zeus is the adjective Deus, which denotes properly of or belonging to Zeus. This meaning, it actually bears an antic drama. But how comes it that in the much earlier Homeric poems, it has the force of bright or glorious without any such restriction to the property of a personal Zeus? Probably because the word was formed before Zeus became a personality, when as yet he was the Zeus, the radiant sky, credited with an impersonal view of its own. Deus, in fact, meant at first of or belonging to the bright sky. and a vestige of its primary meaning is to be found in the frequent Homeric phrase, the bright upper air, and the bright dawn. The transition from brightness in this sense to glory or splendor in general is not hard to follow. Further, when Zeus came to be regarded as an individual sky god, the way was open for Deus, of the bright sky, to take on the more personal meaning of the god Zeus. Thus, on the assumption that Zeus began life as the Zeus, both Homeric and Attic usages are satisfactorily explained. We note in passing that in northeastern Phrygia, Zeus was worshipped as Zeus Deus, a double appellation which recalls the Dea of the Romans, and very possibly attests the survival among the Thrace Phrygian folk of an earlier, not to say primitive, Zeus. Another adjective, Indios, occurs in epic verse with the meaning in broad daylight or at midday. For example, Nestor in the Aeneid describes an exposition in which he had once taken part. At midday, Indio came. We came at midday, Indio, came we to the sacred stream, Alphios. Eidothea, too, in the Odyssey, tells Menelaus the habits of her father, Proteus. What time the sun betrides mid-heaven, there comes shoreward the unerring ancient of the sea. And 50 lines further on, her word is made good. At midday, Indaeus came the ancient from the sea. Similarly, Sudes, cities, the following, similarly, Sudes cites the following couplet, perhaps by Kelly Machos. So while midday, Indaeus endured, and earth grew hot, more brilliant than crystal shone the sky. From this adjective are derived verbs meaning to take a midday siesta, to live in the open air, to grow up in the air. But the adjective itself must have meant originally in the Zeus or in the bright sky, thence passing into the sense in broad daylight at midday. Lastly, there is the adjective eudios, with a clear sky, tranquil. The substantive eudia, a clear sky, calm weather. And the verbs eudion, eudi azeste, to be serene. These all spring from the same root as dios, indios, and alike bear witness to the fact that Zeus once signified the animate sky. It is interesting to observe that the 10th century scholar who compiled the great Greek lexicon known as Etymologicum Magnum seems to have had an inkling of the truth, for in discussing the words Eudeos and Eudea, he suggests as a possible derivation, or because Zeus denotes the sky also. When the pre-anthropomorphic conception of Zeus had developed into the anthropomorphic, the natural tendency would be to forget the former and the latter. We can hardly expect, therefore, to find in extant Greek literature the name Zeus used as a simple equivalent of the sky. Still, there are occasional passages of a more or less colloquial sort in which the ancient usage may be detected. Thus, Aristophanes, in his comedy, Friends of the Frying Pan, makes one of the characters exclaim, "And how should Platon bear the name he does here? Had he not got the best of it, I'll explain. The things of earth surpass the things of Zeus. When you are weighing, 'tis the laden pan. Seeks earth, the empty one goes up toward Zeus." The remark gains in point if we may suppose that toward Zeus was a popular expression for skywards. It certainly appears to be used in that sense by Euripides. He has in his Cyclops the following conversation between Polyphemus, who was returned home unexpectedly, and the chorus of satyrs, who are caught idling and so face their ferocious master with hanging heads. Cyclops: "Look up, not down." Chorus: "There, we are staring up toward Zeus himself. I see the stars. I see Orion too." Plutarch again quotes a witty epigram on Lysippus, the statue of Alexander the Great, with its characteristic upturned gaze. "The man of bronze who looks to Zeus says, so I should opine, this earth I keep for my own use, the sky, Zeus, is for thine." With these passages of comedy and quasi-comedy should be compared certain others of more serious tone, in which the poet says the rays of Zeus, or the light of Zeus, where we should say the light of day. The Iliad thus describes the crash of a battle between Argives and Trojans. The din of both rose to the upper sky, and the rays of Zeus. Hecabe, in the tragedy that Euripides named after her, speaks of her dead son, Polydorus, as no longer in the light of Zeus. In the same poet's Iphigenia at Aulis, the heroine, when she departs to her death, bids adieu to the daylight. O lamp of day and light of Zeus, another life, another lot, henceforth be mine, loved light, farewell. In such passages, it is difficult to determine whether Zeus is conceived as anthropomorphic or not. Anthropomorphism is, however, apparent in Rhesus, where Euripides writes not only the light of the god, but also Zeus, god of light. For 1500 years or more, in fact, till the decay of paganism, the anthropomorphic conception of Zeus held the field. Yet the older view was never very far below the surface, and from time to time, as we shall see, it cropped up in a variety of ways. Even in the extreme decadence of Greek letters, there was a scholastic resuscitation of it. Thus, the original Zeus was simply the radiant daylight sky. With the rise of anthropomorphism, this belief was obscured and overlaid. The Zeus of Hesiodic mythology is described as grandson of an older god, Uranus, the starry midnight sky. In Hellenic times, the two Spartan kings were respectively priests of Zeus, Lacedaemon, and Zeus, Uranios, of the sky. In the Hellenistic age, the latter title was much used by the poets. It afforded a point of contact between the Greek Zeus and the Semitic Baal Shemen, Lord of Heaven. Finally, Byzantine learning spoke of Zeus Uranos, Zeus the sky, a title which is later a title which in letter, though not in spirit, recalled the primary idea of the animate sky. End of section 1, subsection alpha. Section 2, Zeus and the burning sky. Subsection alpha, ether, or ether as the abode of Zeus. As a bright sky god, Zeus lived in the ether, or burning sky. Homer and Theognis speak of him as dwelling in ether. As a notable line in the Iliad says, Zeus's portion was broad heaven and the ether and the clouds. Hence, when he punished Hera, he hung her up in the ether and the cloud. On one occasion, he sent a portent to the Achaeans out of ether. On another, he helped Hector from ether. On another, he came near to flinging Hypnos from ether into the sea. Euripides, in his Melanippe, the wise, made one of the characters cry, "I swear by holy ether, home of Zeus." Aristophanes, after the manner of a caricaturist, slightly distorts the phrase and ridicules the poet for saying ether, broom of Zeus. Again in Clarisippus, Euripides wrote an invocation of earth and sky beginning, "Mightiest earth and ether of Zeus." And in another fragment, describes Perseus as the Gorgon slayer, the winged, his way to the holy ether of Zeus. The Latin poets followed suit and used the borrowed word ether to denote the habitual abode of Zeus. Section 3, Zeus, Lycaos, under the heading Wolf God or Light God, Alpha. On the summit of Mount Lycaon in Arcadia was a fair-famed cult of Zeus Lycaos. Tradition said that Lycaon, son of Pelesgos, had founded the town of Lycosura, high up on the slopes of the mountain, had given to Zeus the surname Lycaos, and had instituted the festival of Lycaea. On the significance of this group of names, scholars are by no means agreed. Some take them to be pre-Greek or non-Greek. Thus, Fick maintains that they represent a Hittite tribe to be identified with Lycaonians and Lycians of Asia Minor, while Baird argues for a Phoenician cult comparable with that of Baal. Most critics, noting the essentially Greek aspect of the names in question, are content to seek an explanation in the language of Greece. But even here, opinions are divided. Some, starting from the undeniable fact that the wolf, Lycos, plays a part in the local myths, holds that Zeus Lycaos was in some sense a wolf god. This view, however, is open to a grave objection. The word Lycaos cannot be derived from Lycos. It must be an adjective formed from a substantive Lyke. But there is in Greek no word as Lyke, wolf. And if there were, it would mean a she-wolf, whereas the myths of Mount Lycaon mention none but he-wolves. Far more probable is the theory of those who understand Lycaos as god of light. The word Lyke is quoted by Macrobius as an old Greek word for daybreak, and its compound amphilike is used in the Iliad of twilight. They belong to a well-known family of words, while numerous relatives in both Greek and Latin. Indeed, our word light is of kindred origin. But etymology, unless supported by ritual and myth, can afford no certain clue to the nature of an ancient deity. Fortunately, the present case that support is forthcoming. Zeus Lykaios was sometimes at least conceived as a sky god, for his priests acted as rainmaker to the district. Again, AESCHYLUS, the tragedian, a younger contemporary of Sophocles, appears to have spoken of Zeus Lykaios as starry-eyed, Esterepos, an epithet of similar formation and of the same meaning. Asteropos is used by Euripides of the aether, or burning sky, in connection with Zeus. This suggests that Zeus Lykaios was a god of the aether. Indeed, Crusier long since pointed out that Zeus Lykaios is none other than the Arcadian Zeus, whom Cicero and Amphilios describe as the son of aether. H. Usner further observes that, just as a Boeotian myth makes Lykaios succeed his brother Nikitios on the throne, so the Arcadian myth makes Lykaion succeed his son Nikitimos, the inference being that both pairs of names denote the alternation of daylight, like, or leak, and darkness, nicht. If Zeus Lykaios, or Lykaios, was thus a god of daylight, certain statements made by Pausanias apropos of his cult gained a fresh significance. Lykaiosura, founded by Lykaion, was the first city that ever the sun beheld. On the very top of Mount Lykaion was a mound of earth known as the altar of Zeus Lykaios, from which the greater part of the Peloponnese was visible. Before the altar stood two columns bearing gilded eagles and facing the sunrise. Finally, Pausanias says, of the wonderful things to be seen on Mount Lykaion, the most wonderful is this. There is a precinct of Zeus Lykaios on the mountain, and no man is allowed to enter it. Should anyone disregard the rule and enter, he cannot possibly live longer than a year. It was said that within the precinct all things, both beasts and men, alike cast no shadow. Consequently, when a beast takes refuge in the precinct, the hunter will not break in along with it, but waits outside and, looking at the beast, sees no shadow cast by it. Now at Siene, on the frontier of Ethiopia, so long as the sun is in the sign of Cancer, shadows are cast neither by trees nor by animals. But in the precinct of Mount Lykaion, there is some lack of shadows at all times and seasons. This marvel, which is attested by other grave and respectable authors, though skeptics were not wanting, probably hangs together with the Pythagorean belief that the souls of the dead cast no shadow and do not wink. The shadowless creature would on this showing be the man or beast already devoted to death. Dr. Frazier, commenting on the passage quoted above, form Pausanias writes, untutored people often regard the shadow as a vital part of a man, and its loss as fatal. This belief is still current in Greece. It is thought that to give stability to a new building, the life of an animal or a man is necessary. Hence, an animal is killed and its blood allowed to flow on the foundation stone, or the builder secretly measures a man's shadow and buries the measure under the foundation stone, or the foundation stone is laid upon a man's shadow. It is supposed that the man will die within a year, obviously because his shadow is believed to be buried under the building. Trespassers on the precinct of Zeus, Lycaeus, not only lost their shadows, but were actually put to death. Plutarch states that such persons were called deer, elephoi, that if they had entered the precinct voluntarily, they were stoned to death, and that if they had entered it through ignorance, they were sent away to Eleutherae. But if the ultimate explanation of the shadowless precinct on Mount Lycaon lies in the connection once thought to exist between shadow and soul, it by no means follows that this was the explanation given by Greeks of the classical period. They may well have forgotten the real meaning of a belief to which they still clung and have attributed it to some irrelevant cause. This is what, in point of fact, they did. Polybios, the historian, who as a native of Megalopolis would take a personal interest in matters Arcadian, writes as follows. Anent certain Carian superstitions, it appears to me that such tales are only fit to amuse children, when they transgress not merely the limits of probability, but those of possibility as well. For instance, to assert that some bodies, when placed in light, cast no shadow, argues a state of extreme obtuseness. Yet Theopompus has done this, for he declares that those who enter the holy precinct of Zeus in Arcadia cast no shadow, which is on a par with the statements that I mentioned just now. Theopompus, then, the historian of Chios, explained the miracle of Mount Lycaon by saying that beasts and men on the summit cast no shadow because they were there placed in light. This can only mean that a divine light encircled the mountaintop and made all shadows impossible. Mount Lycaon, in fact, resembled Olympus, as described in the Odyssey, and was itself called Olympus. Pausanias says, they speak of it also as Olympus, while others of the Arcadians name it the sacred peak. This Olympic glory, though not as Theopompus presumably held, and as Roscher certainly holds, the true explanation of the shadowless precinct would be in thorough keeping with the character of Zeus Lycaeus as the god of light. Section 4. Zeus and Olympus. Alpha. The cult of Zeus on Mount Olympus. Olympus was an ancient, perhaps a pre-Greek name, for a whole series of mountains in Greece and Asia Minor. Of the Arcadian Olympus, I have already spoken. Laconiki had its Olympus near the town of Celesia. Pisa and Elis was situated between two mountains named Ossa and Olympus. Homonyms of the greater Ossa and Olympus in Thessaly in Macedonia. A mountain near Lurion in Attica is still called Olympus, as is another and loftier height near Eritrea in Euboea, and a third in Scyros. A mountain village in Carpathos bears the same name. The Mycenaean Olympus is a mountain chain forming the boundary between Bithynia and Mysia. It was sometimes confused with Mount Ida, indeed four peaks of Mount Ida, opposite to the town of Antandros, bore the name Olympus. There was another Olympus in Galatia. Unless we should identify it with the Mycenaean range, another in Lydia, another in Lycia, yet another in Cilicia, Lesbos too had its Mount Olympus, and Kypros had two heights that bore that name. Finally, Panakia, the fabulous island of Euhemeros, had an Olympus of its own. Of all these mountains, the most important from a religious and mythological point of view is the great Macedonian ridge that culminates in a peak still known as Elibo, soaring to a height of 9,754 feet above sea level. It affords a wide panorama. The eye travels south to Mount Parnassus, southwest to the range of Pindus, north to the confines of Macedonia, east to Mount Athos and the sea beyond. Equally striking is the view of the mountain from below. Dr. Holland, who saw it from Litohoro, writes, "We had not before been aware of the extreme vicinity of the town to the base of Olympus. But when leaving it and accidentally looking back, we saw, through an opening in the fog, a faint outline of vast precipices, seeming almost to overhang the place, and so aerial in their aspect that for a few minutes we doubted whether it might not be a delusion to the eye. The fog, however, dispersed yet more on this side, and partial openings were made, through which, as through arches, we saw the sunbeams resting on the snowy summits of Olympus." Dr. Holland adds that these summits rose into a dark blue sky, far above the belt of the clouds and mist that hung upon the sides of the mountain. The ancients were much impressed by the fact that Olympus rears its crest above the rain clouds. They fancied that birds could not fly over it, and that at such an altitude the air was too thin to support human life. In short, Olympus penetrated the air, or moist sky, and reached the ether, or burning sky. It was, in the Greek sense of the term, an ethereal height, and therefore formed a fitting abode for Zeus, the ethereal god. It is sometimes stated that the only evidence of a Zeus cult on Mount Olympus is the name of the town Dion at its foot. But that is a mistake. Maximus Tyrius informs us that in primitive times, men dedicated to Zeus likewise in places of statues, the top of mountains. Olympus and Ida, and any other mountain that nears the sky. An anonymous Latin mythographer records an actual cult of Zeus on Mount Olympus, and sundry details concerning it are mentioned by Solinus, Plutarch, and Augustine. On the summit of the mountain, there was an altar to Zeus, and it was believed that the offering left upon it would not be affected by wind or weather, but would be found again after a year's interval, precisely as they had been left. Every year, victims were led in procession up the mountainside, and those who led them, on reaching the top, found intact certain letters formed in the ashes on the occasion of their last visit. The same beliefs attached to Mount Cyllene in Arcadia, and to the mountain Athos in Chalcidice. The Zeus cult of Mount Olympus has even survived in a modified form to the present day. On the highest peak of the mountain is a small chapel of St. Elias, built of rude stones collected on the spot. To it once a year go the monks from the monastery of St. Dionysios in the ravine of Litochoro. Their procession starts at night by torchlight, and they say a mass in the chapel on the summit. Here, as elsewhere, Zeus himself has been replaced by St. Elias, but his eagle still haunts the height, at least in popular imagination. A folk song heard by Mr. J.S. Stewart Glennie when ascending from the pass of Petra makes Olympus exclaim, "I 70 mountain summits have, and 62 fountains. To every bush an armatole, to every branch a clefet. And perched upon my highest peak there sits a mighty eagle, a mirror in his talon grasped. He holds on high exalted, and in it his charms admire, and on his beauty gazes."